Why is it that we bond our neutrals and grounds at the service panel, but we don't do it at the sub panels that are, say, in the garage or somewhere else in the house? This is really important, actually, so stay tuned. What's going on, my friends? Dustin Stelzer with Electrician U. This was a question that was sent in to me from YouTube. It says, Mr. Stelzer, hello, I'm a big fan. Thanks for putting out excellent content. Can you please make a video explaining why the secondary breaker box, meaning a sub panel, not the main service panel, why the secondary breaker box, the one in my garage in the house, is not bonded between the neutral and ground. It is fed by a double 50 amp breaker in my 200 amp service, and the bonding occurs there. My IBEW buddy swears I did it incorrectly, but I got my understanding from something on one of your videos. This is from Darren Eckler on YouTube. So Darren, let's get into this on the whiteboard. Now, before we get started, make sure you get your U Crew merch. So we've got Electrician U shirts right now. We've got a whole bunch of variations of hats. So if you want just the Electrician U EU logo, or you can get the U Crew if you want to be part of the U Crew, come on, come join us, U Crew. But go get your merch right now. We sell out very, very quickly, so they're for a limited time only, but we're constantly adding new stuff. There's all kinds of people that have been throwing tons of suggestions at us. But if you want any EU merch, check out the link below, electricianu.com. All right, so this whole issue of why we bond at the service panel, we bring our neutrals and our grounds together. Let me draw the bond. I'll just go like this so that you know that they're bonded together. This is what we do at a service panel. We make sure all of the neutrals and all of the grounds, all of the grounded conductors and all of the grounding conductors are all bonded together at a single point that is connected to earth. Now, the connected to earth, that's a different thing than just bonding them together. What we're doing is making sure that everything that's grounded in a structure does not have current on it. You know, our ground, our equipment grounded conductor should not have current on it. But in a fault, in a ground fault situation where maybe one of these hots like slips off its termination and hits the metal casing, when somebody goes up and touches that metal of that like dryer in this case, they don't get shocked. There's not current on that ground, but that ground needs to make a completed circuit all the way back to the transformer up at the pole for the breaker to trip. If it doesn't have a complete circuit, it's not going to trip a breaker. You're just gonna have something that's potentially energized and it's a hazard and somebody can get shocked or electrocuted. And there is a difference. For those of you who didn't know, electrocution normally means death. And getting shocked just means getting shocked. All right. So what we have in this situation, we have a service panel outside. We got a sub panel in a garage. The sub panel is going to be fed off of a breaker. So we've got a 220 breaker that's feeding over to feed our panel. With it, we carry an equipment grounding conductor. And then we have a neutral or a grounded conductor in code. So we run all of these over to a new panel. From here in the sub panel, let's say that we've got a dryer. And we ran 220 over to this dryer. We also ran a neutral with it and a ground with it. It's a four-prong, modern, fancy dryer. The reason that we need to keep everything separated is a concept called objectionable current. So, it means objection. There's a problem. There's something wrong. There's like, we need to address something. Objectionable current is when there is current on something and there shouldn't be current on something, or more specifically, there's current in two different places going in two different directions where it should not be. Now, objectionable current would be if we had current in a fault condition where anytime we have a fault, we want to be very precise about where we're allowing current to flow. We don't want it to just kind of go wherever the hell it wants to go, because we could fry other equipment. There's a lot of things that could happen. People could get shocked. For some reason, you're standing on something metal in a shower, you get shocked. So we want to make sure that we control where current is flowing. So we definitely don't want this ground conductor to act as a neutral. We don't want it to carry current all the time. Neutrals are designed to carry current and grounds are not. So if we have an objectionable current on a ground when we're supposed to have current on a neutral, we could have it going down both paths. So essentially, if we didn't bond our neutral and our ground together, we could have current flowing on the neutral and on the ground at the same time, both trying to get back to source and finding whatever means they needed to. You'd have parallel paths of current. So we always want to try to minimize that. We want one guaranteed place where fault current can go to get back to source. So if we have a situation where a fault happens, a ground fault specifically, not a short circuit. A lot of people misuse this terminology. A short circuit is when you have a circuit that has a shortcut in it. Basically, it has nothing to do with ground. It's either hot to neutral or hot to hot. A ground fault is specifically when you have a hot conductor touching your equipment grounding conductor or touching ground. They call it a ground fault. So a ground fault and a short circuit, two different things. So say in this situation, we have a ground fault. Let's figure out where the current's gonna travel. Say that this red conductor for some reason contacts the case. Our ground is contacting the case as well. So now we have current that is going from this breaker through the case, through the equipment grounding conductor, going all the way back over here. And since it's bonded to neutral, it has a path and it has a completed path all the way up to the transformer. So that will cause current to flow momentarily. It'll cause so much current because there's no load in between this red and this green anymore. For electricity to really operate, there has to be a load in between it. So as current's flowing, there's something that's resisting or that's impeding that current flow, and that makes electricity travel at kind of a responsible rate enough for us to use it. If there's no resistance to that current flow, it's going to go unimpeded very, very fast. Things are gonna get really hot. It's gonna become chaotic very, very quickly. You're gonna have insulation melting off the conductors. You might even liquefy the conductors and completely melt the conductors themselves, depending on the situation, the heat and available fault current and all of that. So you need impedance, right? You need something impeding the circuit for it to do meaningful work. Well, in this case, we have a hot that's touching a case. There's no resistance at all. There's nothing impeding it. So that current's gonna go flying through the circuit. So we have a complete circuit. I should probably have drawn this red also. So on the red from our transformer up here, we've got like the start of the circuit, travels down through the reds, all the way over here, back all the way through the ground. And that ground, because the ground and the neutral are bonded, that it's gonna travel, that current's gonna travel back up on the neutral, which is going to allow an incomplete circuit for the entirety of that circuit to be complete. So current will flow, so much of it'll flow that this breaker right here is gonna trip because that's what the breaker's supposed to do. If we did not bond this, If we did not bond the neutral and the ground, then this fault would occur, but current wouldn't travel because we don't have a complete loop anywhere. So we just have all of this metal enclosure, this entire metal conductor, the metal inside this panel, the metal that the panel is hooked up to, this conductor, ground rod, everything metal all along the way will have potential on it. So if you touch this, and you were to say touch a neutral or touch anything else that's at a different potential, current would flow through you as a way to try to get back to the source where it's always trying to get to. So nothing would actually happen. It wouldn't clear a breaker. This fault would happen. All of this stuff would have potential on it. Doesn't necessarily mean it would be energized, but it would have potential available depending on if you touched from one potential to another potential to create a difference of potential or a voltage for pressure to push current through you. So it's a dangerous situation if we don't bond these together, and we're never gonna get the breaker to trip if we don't bond them. The neutral is our path back to source, and that's how we have a completed loop. In a transformer, we have our pole that has a huge transformer out here. We've got the utility company with its smokestacks and a big generator in here, and we've got a house. So we actually have two completed circuits when we talk about utility. There might be more than that because distribution, it changes from voltage, you know, multiple different times. But what we have is we have a primary circuit that comes from a generator. So it means we have one conductor that goes all the way out in the field, brings power out to a transformer that's up on a pole. It's one piece of wire unbroken the entire time. It comes back out, goes back to the generator where it is also another loop. We have one continuous circuit coming from the utility company to the power pole that's out at your house. That's a complete circuit. That's how current flows. Then we have a secondary circuit. I'll do that a different color. What we oftentimes call the secondary out in the field. If you hear somebody saying, oh, the primary or the secondary, they're talking about on a transformer. So we've got our secondary circuit, and the secondary comes down. We have our black, we have our red. We still don't have a completed circuit, right? When we land these conductors inside the panel, we're breaking the circuit. There's no completion to them. So what we do is we run all these circuits out from the panel to loads. And from here, this breaker is gonna touch the black. It's gonna go out to our washing machine. It's gonna hook up to the washing machine. Inside the washing machine, there's gonna be a motor. So basically another coil, kind of like this. And then we're gonna have our red conductor that we bring from a breaker, you know, on the red phase, and we go straight out to that. So when we flip a switch, like say there's a switch on one of these, you know, the washing machine or the dryer is off and we push a button to start it, we close a switch and we connect this load. So now we have current in a complete loop traveling, and that's why that washer or that dryer is on. You shut it off, it opens the circuit and it no longer has current moving through it. So it has to have a completed circuit somehow to travel. The neutral, and if I didn't state this enough, the neutral point is always going to be the middle point in the system. So we have a neutral that we run to the transformer as well. That is how this green that's connected to the case of this, that's connected to the case of this, that's connected to the ground rod. Again, the ground rod doesn't have anything to do with tripping a breaker. It's there for a different reason. But that means if we're bonding all of our metal stuff to our neutral, then anytime we have current that goes from one of the hots to any pieces of metal around electrical equipment, now it has a complete loop. It has a complete loop on neutral through red all the way around. That's how we get that breaker to trip. If we did not bond those things, it would not happen. We wouldn't have a breaker that trips. We would just have a whole bunch of metal that has potential on it to hurt or kill somebody because it's energized, or it's waiting to be energized because there's potential on it. There's a voltage that is available on it. That's why we, on the secondary panels or the sub panels, we never bond. And that means if you have like 50 panels in a house, I don't know why you would, but if you had 50 panels, you would not bond the neutral to ground on any of them at all. The only place you want to bond is at that service panel. Now, the reason for this, if you sit and think about it, it actually kind of makes sense. So I drew basically a service, and then all of these are sub panels. So say this is like at one end of the house, this is at another end of the house, this is at like on the other end of the house somewhere. Each one of the panels feeds another panel, right? So we've got a completed loop all the way from the service, all the way through red, all the way to our piece of equipment. We've got, you know, neutral, that's the same thing, goes all the way from the service, all the way through neutral. So essentially red and neutral have a complete loop here inside of the piece of equipment. Let me just draw, we'll say like there's a winding in there. So you can see, right, this is a closed loop. It goes all the way through and all the way back. But the ground, you'll notice, is a completely separate thing. It's not trying to form a loop for current to go through a breaker and be a part of the system. All it's trying to do is bond all of the metal things together and go back and reference to ground and reference to neutral at this one point. So this is the point where we put a bonding jumper in at the service. So if we have a short circuit, let's say, or a ground fault, sorry. Say this red conductor for some reason just flops off and like boom, hits the case. Well, we have a path, so now we know that we are going through this red all the way through this entire thing. And then we have a path on ground all the way back to neutral to go back up to the service to form our complete loop. So that is a complete circle. I know it's kind of like drawn crazy, but it is. It's a complete loop. If that bonding jumper was gone and that ground fault happened, there would be no way for this breaker to trip. It would just stay in an energized state because there is no complete loop to make the breaker trip. Now, objectionable current, what that speaks to is, say we have a ground fault, and on every one of these panels, I'm just gonna draw a quick bonding jumper. We have bonding jumpers so that every single neutral and every single ground are bonded at every single place. What happens is in a ground fault like that situation, now we have two paths that current could take at the same time going through the system, and that's what we don't want. So current could take this path and go all the way through and could make it back up to the panel, right? That's okay. But now that our grounds and neutrals are bonded, it could also take the path through neutral the entire way and end up back at the service. So now we have two parallel paths that current can take, and we don't want that. That's an irresponsible thing to do. We want to make sure that it goes through one singular path only. Reason being, if there's any loads on any of these panels, which there will be, there's breakers everywhere, but there's gonna be loads, and say we got laptops and TVs and all these things hooked up, well, they're all hooked up to that neutral. So we don't want a ground fault to go through equipment as well as go through the ground. That's the entire reason that we have a ground, is for this purpose, to direct that fault current elsewhere. Now, say we have a short circuit. Instead of a ground fault, say instead of this conductor flopped off and hit the case and it was a ground fault, meaning the hot is touching ground, say we have a short circuit. So now we've got like a black and a white that are touching together. Well, instead of just clearing the fault in the black and white, now we've got bonds from neutral, from the white to the green, the neutral to the grounds everywhere. So now that short circuit current is traveling on all of this metal stuff, and that's an objectionable path because the short circuit should be taken care of through a breaker, through that hot and that neutral. It should be one complete loop. We shouldn't introduce metal parts to that short circuit because a short circuit is a very different thing. It's still a fault, but it's not a ground fault. So in either case, you're providing two different paths for current to take, which means it could go anywhere that it wants to take. It could go on everything metal, but it could also go through every piece of equipment and, you know, anything that you have wired in this entire place. And so it could start frying equipment and things like that. So it's silly. You don't want to bond anything anywhere, but the one place you do want to bond everything is back here at the service, because it's the only way that ground fault current can make it to the neutral and actually complete a circuit. And the only way a breaker trips is if there is a completed circuit for that current to keep traveling through. If there's not a complete circuit, no current travels. So we just have this potential over here on everything metal, and anything that touches between two points, current's gonna go through it. So that's the hazard of it. So I hope that makes a little bit more sense. We just do not want two different parallel paths. We want one path for fault current to take, and we want to connect it back and bond it right here so that current goes along the ground and back up to the utility, up to the transformer, and clears that fault, actually opens that breaker. Grounding and bonding is kind of a crazy thing. There's a whole bunch of other different situations. If you have transformer, whether or not you have a generator, how it needs to be grounded, whether or not you have a floating neutral, a lot of different things to consider. So grounding and bonding, which is Article 250 in code, is a really heavily talked about topic. But as an electrician, I think that's a good place to start diving in and trying to figure some of this stuff out, because it's actually very, very important. Grounding has a lot to do with life safety and people not getting injured or hurt, equipment not getting destroyed. So it's very important to know about that kind of stuff. So that was a great question. Thank you so much for your time. I love you crazy people. Put more comments below. I'll make more videos like these. Talk to you soon. Discount music and video.